So I'm not hearing anything, but I'm seeing another question. Will the metaverse impact schooling when it is fully implemented? I want to just unpack what the metaverse means. When people use a term like the metaverse, what they fail to recognize is, in many ways, aspect of the metaverse are still with us. And I'm not sure if everybody's hearing me, but aspect of the metaverse are still. If you think about the amount of time, particularly young people spend on their cell phones, which has been exacerbated because of COVID, you talk to your friends on social media, you post videos, you spend a lot of your leisure time on a digital device. Now, that digital device is also communicating with other digital devices. And so really there's many aspects of the metaverse that is already this conversation is happening over Zoom. So it's many aspects of the metaverse is already impacting how we interact with each other. So schooling will not be left spared from that. As a matter of fact, COVID has accelerated online learning, and the reasons why so many people are so excited about a listing like EduFocal is because EduFocal has made a bet on online learning for a long time, and actually in COVID launched an online school, and as a result of that, the feeling is that more and more of our education is going to have to take place through those mechanisms. So yes, absolutely. One, the metaverse is already with us. What people are seeking to do is make it a more pervasive part of a technology. Some companies are already betting on things like gaming being a big part of the metaverse. People are betting on it affecting work in a certain way, but it's absolutely with us already. Are there any ongoing programs that allow students to showcase their innovation, the potential? Absolutely. Demos. So there, previous presenters spoke a little bit about the accelerators that are with us. I'm going to give you guys a website for my own company. We operate an accelerator called Digital Housing Practice Labs. If you're seeing, I don't know if you're seeing, but we operate an accelerator as well. And for some of those companies that come through our accelerator, we actually provide funding through Esther Finance for those companies. Esther Group Co. Is the website, or estherventures.com, ESTER Ventures, VN. TURES.com. You can submit a pitch deck. We have an accelerator program. But beyond that, you have places like the Branson Center of Entrepreneurship, which I came through the Branson Center. I did the Branson Center program. You have things like Tech Beach that has been launched, and they operate across the Caribbean. There is Rev Up Jamaica, which is run in a collaboration with NCB, and Sandra Glasgow is a part of that. JBDC has also a program. DBJ has some support. So there are a number of programs. You don't even have to stay in Jamaica if you're looking to do. One of my good friends from the Branson Center did Draper's School for Genius in San Francisco. Those programs, most of those programs provide you with financial support to actually participate in them. So if you apply online, if you search online and apply to these programs, many of them will provide you with financial support. I'm a Young Leaders of the Americas professional fellow. That program paid for me to go to the States, paired me with a mentor when I did the program. And actually, that mentor recently, and I started to do business together through an investment from that firm through a company called Purpose Works. So there. There are a number of these programs all over the world. Everybody's trying to attract entrepreneurs because entrepreneurs solves problems. So if you're into thinking, what's called design thinking or systems thinking, and you see problems that you're trying to solve, there's absolutely a number of resources that you have access to that can help you solve these problems. You can connect with me directly and I can provide you with any additional information. Thank you very much, Mr. Peart, your team, for inviting me. Unfortunately, I actually have to jump because I have another engagement, but I hope everybody benefited from the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nixon. Wealth of knowledge, and we really do appreciate it. We're on to our fourth presentation by Mr. Alex Morrissey. And as I mentioned earlier, he's going to be speaking on lessons from the pandemic, online possibilities or not. And of course, Ms. Tiffany Turner is going to come and introduce Mr. Morrissey. Mr. Morrissey, are you with us?
Yes, I'm here. Morning.
Awesome. All right, hang tight.
Hello again, everyone. I love what I do because no day ever feels like the same. If it feels like you're working, then you need to work or go somewhere else. Words from Alex Morrissey. Alex Morrissey is a digital media maven who, at just 30-something, is at the helm of Jamaica's ongoing digital and tech revival. He is currently the managing director of Esirom Limited, a full-service digital media agency managing and creating levels of content for some of the largest brands within the Caribbean. Founded in 2015, the company currently boasts a wide client list, both locally and regionally, of which majority are some of the largest brands across the Caribbean. Seprod, Sopigen, Surge, Betty, Victoria Mutual, Guinness, Smirnoff, Grab and Go, among others. In 2018, he launched Esirom Indonesia and has continued to grow by not only expanding the company's service offerings, but also through launching a cloud server, which provides ease of access for clients to securely view their content, even without internet access. His journey began in 2008. When he founded and launched Jamaican's Music, one of the very first digital media mega hubs, ranking top 25 of all web pages on Facebook at the time, for all things reggae and dancehall related, spanning music, videos, interviews, track lists, and news. This media hub is not only aimed at documenting the dynamic and ever-shifting persona of Jamaica's rich musical landscape, but acted as the stepping stone for Morrissey to impart his skills and experience to companies open to growing their online presence. He continued on his path, and while doing so, managed to amass numerous awards and gain further allocates. In 2012, he won the Jamaica Observer's Mogul in the Making competition, was named the Caribbean Outlier from the Arthur Lockjack Graduate School of Business, and was the youngest recipient of the private sector organization of Jamaica's 50 under 50 Top Business Leaders Award. The young mogul, Alex, has also gained recognition and won the Global Entrepreneur of the Year at the International Business and Academic Excellence Awards in 2019. The Entrepreneur of the Year from Jamaica Chamber of Commerce in 2018, the Caribbean Advertising Federation's American Advertising Awards Silver Award for Consumer Website in 2020. Jamaican's music also opened doors to a performing arts initiative challenging the thought that success should be a drink enjoyed by everyone. And if Alex and his company can be a vessel to help at least one person sip from the glass of success, they'll contently do so. He continues to support the arts industry through Earth Hour Jamaica, which was first held in 2013. Earth Hour organizers had reached out to Alex to join their massive world movement against climate change, and through the magnetic pull of highly influential artists and musicians. The concert was able to garner the support of over 4,000 patrons who enjoyed an evening packed with not only live music, but also education about the cause. Alex's commitment to supporting the creative industry saw him partnering more recently with the Indigo Conference. That's one of Jamaica's first creative-led and executed conferences in 2021 to provide four $50,000 grants to creatives. Alex Morrissey continues to achieve great feats as a young innovator, simultaneously redefining the limits of success with unparalleled results. Be sure to keep him on your radar, slowly shaping the future of Jamaica's online experience. Please put your hands together and welcome Alex Morrissey.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me a part of this session today. Like previous presenters, I too kind of just want to have a conversation as well. So thank you for that introduction. I feel like it's majority of the introduction I was going to give, so I can skip over some of that. And before I jump into the lessons that you can learn from the pandemic and, you know, the online possibilities, I kind of want to go into a little bit more of a deep dive of the process from starting Jamaican's Music as a website and then transitioning that into the business that is SRM today. So just to give you guys some background information, Jamaican's Music was started in 2008. And I had no intention to go into the business industry. So I didn't study business. I didn't do any business classes in high school or university. So my experience is all, I guess, self-taught and learning from, you know, mistakes and opportunities. So the website started off really as a school project. So it was developed while I was in school, kind of forgotten about. And then I brought it back to life when I came back to Jamaica after finishing university. So it was a weird time because I already had just gotten a full-time position at a web agency, and I was already working. You know, it's a new job, so you want to put in the time. You work more than the 8 hours a day, especially because this is not an industry that I was trained in. It's not what my degree is in. My degree is actually in product design, and my goal was always to work, you know, at Samsung or Apple and create the next generation of high-end consumer cell phones. So taking our website and making it into a business at that time wasn't something new. Other persons were doing it, many successful websites, but no one had a website that focused on music for Jamaica and incorporating both the education aspect, so you can learn all about the different genres of Jamaican music. And many people don't realize it's more than reggae and dancehall. And also, how do you convert that to a business? So most of us now, we have the opportunity, and there are free resources out there where you can create your own website. I mean, even if you have a Gmail account, you know, you have the option to create a free website through their service. So when I initially started, everything was all custom coded, and I had to learn all of this. But then you have a website, you get some people to it. How do you then transition that into a business? And that's one of the things that I struggled with for many, many years with this particular site, because music is an industry where there's a lot of money pumped into the entertainment side, but not so much on the promotion side. So convincing persons that, you know, they should advertise through the site, or you can be featured and you have to pay for it, was a bit of a challenge. But through research, I discovered Google Ads, and, you know, Google pays you to post ads on your website. And the more people visit and click and interact with these ads, the more you get paid. So the transition to corporate was actually, again, just by chance. And, you know, everyone needs to pay attention when these things happen, because they do generally happen throughout businesses. And you just have to kind of seize that opportunity when it presents itself. So for Jamaican's music, what happened is I focus a lot on the marketing aspect of it. And Facebook was just kind of taking off in Jamaica at the time. So, you know, like what everybody would normally do, create a page and start posting. So I would be driving persons from Facebook to the website to get more traffic in the hopes of generating revenue from that. And the interesting thing that happened was, because Facebook is, you know, global, and the way that it was structured, persons could easily find the content that we're posting. And the database that we were acquiring, the people liking the page, it just increased, you know, tenfold every day. So we're at the point where, you know, we had a couple of 100,000 likes on Facebook. And around the same time, Digicel had put out an article to say, you know, they have the most Facebook fans in Jamaica, and then later they said in the Caribbean. And I just use it as an opportunity to just comment under the article saying, you know, there's another business out there that has more or on par with Digicel. And not expecting anything really to come out of it, except maybe a few people would click the link from there and then go to the to my page. But what ended up happening was the Glean actually did another article to say, wait, you know, Digicel has competition, there's this music website, and, you know, they have more followers technically in Jamaica than Digicel. So that kind of sparked a little friendly rivalry online between Jamaican music and Digicel. And we would have, you know, either Glean Observer routinely do a little update article and kind of say who has the most following, until, you know, Digicel and I agreed that, you know, we should actually do this for real and see who would be the first to get to 1 million followers. So that happened. We got to 1 million maybe 2 or 3 weeks after that, Digicel a couple months later. So what happened was Digicel wanted to know, what were we doing different? And, you know, they asked all the various questions. How much are you spending on advertising? The response is $0. They said, okay, are you posting it any differently? Like, what's the strategy behind it? And really, the strategy at the time was just to push content to the users on the website who wanted to experience relevant music to them. So the website expanded from just Jamaicans who create music in Jamaica to anyone in the world who is creating Jamaican music in any of the genres that we have. And that sparked Digicel to say, you know what, okay, let us try to tap into music as a catalyst to get more users on our platform. So we actually collaborated, and that was the first instance of revenue, real revenue for the website as a business, because we did a couple apps for Digicel in collaboration. So due to that success, I realized that there's an opportunity to do more work with corporate entities through Jamaican music. However, down the line, you know, the various accounts departments started to say, why are we paying a music website for marketing services? So I seek some advice, and, you know, not having any business background except the basics, how to register a business name, open a bank account in the business name, I didn't really understand that structure. So I did my own research, formed a new entity which would focus on the corporate work that the music website was generating. And then essentially that's how SRM was formed, and Jamaican Music became a brand underneath SRM. So I say all of this to say that without even realizing, I was creating the foundation to create the business that exists today. So the ability for you as an entrepreneur is that you need to be able to shift and adapt to what the market wants, even if this is your idea, this is your baby business, and you kind of don't want to let it go. So even though my passion is music, it's not what pays the bills. So you have to find a way to adapt your original idea of how you're going to make money through this business idea if that's not what the market wants. So just to tell you a little bit more about SRM in a nutshell, we're a full service digital agency that specializes in social media content creation and technology solutions. So it didn't start that way. It started off as one service, and then once we excelled at one, we added on, but all three different divisions complement each other as a whole business. So just so that you have a better understanding of what we do, because a lot of times persons ask, you know, we know that you do this or we know that, but we don't really understand from a visual perspective. So I'm just going to play a little 1 minute recap of what we did last year, so you can kind of get an idea of the variety of services that we do. So it's just going to be a 1 minute video.
Alex, could you share sound, please?
Sure, let me see what's wrong on my end. Louisa, you know, from videography to website, social media, apps, there's just a little bit of everything that we do. So, shifting gears now to the pandemic and how it has affected our business and how, well, it affected everyone, but specifically what was going on before the pandemic, during, and then in this weird post-pandemic, not really post-phase that we're currently are in. So for us as a business, we typically cover all events for our clients, highlight them. You know, it was business as usual, but as a company, we were always looking into what's next. So it's very important as entrepreneurs that you're always researching in the industry, researching locally, internationally, what your competitors are doing, what your partners are doing, because that's how you're going to prepare for the possibilities that may come. So during the pandemic now, we know everything was shut down, which meant one major section of our business was also shut down. So not being able to cover events, and you know, we would be doing large scale events like a reggae song fest. So that's a big hit. So what we had to do is kind of adapt. And we know that we already have all the equipment needed for live streaming services. So we started to do it even before the pandemic. We were already doing live streaming, but the demand was not there. So we only did one every now and then. And even at that point, we still did not have all the equipment we needed. So because we knew this was happening, we quickly invested in the necessary equipment that was going to instill confidence in our clients that we can do this for them. And then we did a lot of, I would say, trial work. So there's still work that the client gives us, but not necessarily that they're going to pay for, because you need proof of concept. So we would do a few of these so that they can experience what a live production would be, and us as well to learn from the mistakes, so that when we know that this will kick in, we will be ready to go. So that allowed us to think, okay, what are all of the different options that people normally do on a day-to-day that we can offer them a solution for during this pandemic? So we came up with a list and we thought about every possible thing, and it came down to live streaming of general events, sporting events, webinars, conferences. But how do you make that interesting? So, you know, taking the typical TV broadcasting approach where you insert different graphics and pre-recorded content and, you know, add lower thirds when somebody is talking, it pops up. So you have to think about all the different elements so that you are very prepared for when that time comes. But also it's important to note that the opportunity didn't just present itself. So it wasn't because we're already an established company that all our clients were like, yes, we're going to do all live streaming, all our webinars with you guys. We have to prove to them. So that's something that you will have to do as well. You have to show that you have the ability and the capacity to do it. Another interesting thing that happened during this pandemic phase is QR codes. We have been preaching for a few years now that, you know, utilize QR codes in your marketing campaigns. It was ahead of its time, I would say, not just from a need to use QR codes, but also the fact that most of the phones, you had to download a third-party app to scan the codes. Now, most phones come with it built in, and people are utilizing it for many different reasons, not just, you know, marketing campaigns, but simple things in stores to provide your menus and so forth. We also noticed that because this was going to happen, there was going to be a significant amount of time that persons spend on social media or online in general. So you spend more time consuming content, and the content takes the form of what brands post, what you see from the various influencers or celebrities that you follow, to streaming services like a Netflix, Hulu, and so forth. So because we also identified this as one of the things that were going to happen, we made different plans for our clients and came up with campaigns or content campaigns that will allow us to create content and then place it on the platforms that are designed for long form consumption, such as a YouTube or Facebook. And of course, you know, there are difficulties that you experience along the way. So for example, there's this trend of wanting to go live on Instagram. So I'm sure everyone on this call may have seen it in the past where, you know, you have your little design around it and then you have your small box within your vertical. So personally, I despise Instagram lives when they're done in high quality production, because the viewing experience is just not what IG Live was meant for. So that's something that we haven't even been able to encourage our clients to do, is to record in a vertical format or to shoot in a vertical format so that persons will be able to consume it better. And then, you know, we had certain things like public services coming online. Tax office really updated their stuff to make it easy for persons to pay all the various taxes. And, you know, even passport renewals. So all services kind of started to become digitized, even though they're not fully there yet, as what we're accustomed to when we're using international platforms. And then, you know, there's a surge of persons wanting to upskill and learn more in different industries and use that time when you're at home to kind of come up with this. And then all the other various categories that we know, travel, more apps, the banking sectors, getting better digital services, and of course, all the delivery companies that now exist. So I would say, based on this, you know, you have your pre-pandemic, which you don't really know that there's going to be a pandemic coming, but we have some idea if you follow international news. And that's the time where you should be thinking about how can you benefit from, you know, what's going to happen. Because ultimately, you know, it's not the greatest thing to think about that people are profiting during this time, but it's the reality. And to survive, you're going to have to shift. And enduring, you're going to have to be ready for that and confident in your ability to offer these services. And then post, which is where we are, you have to remember that all the expectations that you had set during this period, your clients or your customers are now going to expect that they got everything that they used to get in the pre and the during, and now you're at this stage. So we're gonna see more hybrid events, or there's gonna be an expectation that every time there's a stage show now, it should be live streamed, or every time there's a conference, even if it's in person, there should be a live streaming option. And then all these other services that came online there's going to be an expectation that they should just be gradually getting better. So to summarize it, I like to do things in three steps or three goals, just to kind of keep it simple. So research and study. So you're studying the industry locally and internationally for these opportunities. You're going to learn the necessary skills, or if you have a team, you're going to get them up to that level that you need them. You're going to be planning and preparing, so investing in the tools that you need. And, you know, for us, the production equipment is very expensive. But what also came out of this pandemic is that you have persons who are overseas, and they are going through the same things that we are here in Jamaica. So they started to find different options for equipment, lower end equipment that can still do the same things. So that whole research period is going to be important to make sure that, you know, you're not shelling out $1 million on one camera when you could buy three cameras for the same amount, even though they may not be as high quality, but you're doing it so that, you know, once it starts to take off as a service, then you can reinvest and upgrade those cameras or whatever it is that you have. So investing in the tools, and so that's physical and that's also digital. So there's tons of open source software that you can utilize to help your business. And it comes in a variety of things. So you have from accounting to even production, to even how this is being presented currently. You know, it's using a free open source software that anybody can download and use. And then to create a plan. So create a plan, three goals. And then you can break down those goals into smaller goals. But if you have this long list, eventually you're going to be overwhelmed with all the things that you need to accomplish. So personally, I find that three goals keeps me in check. Another important thing that came out of this for us, and I know for a lot of other businesses as well, is partnerships. So you look at your quote unquote competitors and realize that, you know, because of how the market has changed, it's either going to be the client is going to want to use one provider, or they're going to source the cheapest provider. So you can use this opportunity to meet with your competitors and possibly turn them into partners. We've done this with a few persons that execute events, and, you know, when the influx of business comes in and they can't manage, they outsource to us and we outsource to them, just to kind of keep the relationship going. It's also a good time to renegotiate, to leverage opportunity of the pandemic. You know, a lot of places have been doing grants for you to get your business up and running, but also there are a lot of free resources online. So going back to number one, you can find everything online these days. And then the third step would be to launch and repeat this step. So it's a never-ending cycle. As an entrepreneur, you're always going to have to optimize your approach for your services and the business, and you're always going to be looking for the next problem that you're going to come up with a solution for. So those are my points. So I'd like, anybody has any comments or questions, to just drop it below.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morrissey. Now, the information that we've been getting so far have been really, they're pretty much a lot, but they are, you know, very valuable, and we really do appreciate it. Some of the things that Mr. Morrissey pretty much shared on really opened our eyes to the whole idea that even after the pandemic, there is still room for us to pretty much go and grow as entrepreneurs. Thank you so much again, Mr. Morrissey, for sharing, for explaining to us that even though something might be our passion, it's not necessarily the one that pays the bills, also for encouraging us to invest in the tools that we pretty much need in order to become successful entrepreneurs. So a lot of things are being said, a lot of things are there to unpack and unload. And there are lots of things that we can walk away with, lots of information that we can walk away with this afternoon as we step into entrepreneurship, the choice for a sustainable future. Are there any questions for Mr. Morrissey before he goes on to his next engagement? I see he's also sharing a link in the chat, so make sure that you grab onto those. All right. We are at that point where we're going to be entertained again by my goodly brother. And he's coming back to light up our little lives. After which, we're going to have our keynote speaker, Mr. Gary Matalon. Now, if there's anybody that is able to video themselves and show me a note that they've been jotting down, then you'll be able to get a prize. So if you're able to hold up a piece of paper that you have scribbled on to say, yes, I have been attentive in class, I've been writing down something, then you most definitely get a prize. Is there such a person out there in virtual wonderland while Mr. White comes to us? Any brave soul that can hold up something to say, I see you scribbling it down now, I see you with my virtual eyes, I see her hurrying up to scribble down. let me see if there's anybody who has been taking notes that is able to hold up their little piece of paper to say, yes, I've been taking notes. A lot of presentations have gone on. From morning, we have seen entrepreneurship, the Jamaican look. That was done by Miss Andrea Williams. We have also gone through the presentation by Mrs. Jacqueline Lloyd Carter that brought us financing and the small business operators. We have heard from Mr. Javette Nixon about creativity and innovation. And of course, Mr. Morrissey from lessons from the pandemic, online possibilities or not. So we have had great presentations so far, and we have our keynote speaker that's coming to us to kind of, you know, give the big punch, and then we'll close after that, all right? Mr. White, are you ready? Okay, take it away.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. This song is called Believe, and it's really about thanking whoever believes in us or who have been believing in us.
I don't know how I got here. I knew it wouldn't be easy, but your faith in me was so clear. It didn't matter how many times I got knocked on the floor. You knew one day I would be standing tall. Just look at me now. 'Cause everything starts from something. Something would be nothing, nothing if your heart didn't dream with me. Where would I be? If you didn't believe, believe, yeah. There were days when I was just broken, you know. There were nights when I was doubting myself, but you kept my heart from falling. It doesn't matter how many times I got knocked on the floor, you knew one day I would be standing tall. Just look at us now, and everything starts from something. Something would be nothing, nothing if your heart didn't dream with me. Where would I be? If you didn't believe, 'cause everything starts from something. Something would be nothing, nothing if your heart didn't dream with me. Where would I be? If you didn't believe.
What a profound message. Everything starts from something. Where would I be if I didn't believe? And that's some encouraging words for us who are looking towards the world of entrepreneurship. Sometimes you think that the idea full. Sometimes you think that, you know, nobody will take to the idea. But before you can get to that everything stage, you know, you have to start from something. And when you look back, when you reach and you look back, you can say to yourself, where would I be if I didn't believe? Thank you so much for those profound words, dear brother. At this time, I'm going to invite Mrs. Georgia Galloway Hill to introduce Mr. Gary Matalon. Mr. Matalon, are you on the line? Are you with us?
I am. How are you?
I am great. How are you?
Not bad at all. Enjoying the presentation.
Yes, sir. You sound sturdy. You sound ready up to come and deliver. Are you ready?
Always ready.
Yes, man, because we have a book, our pencil ready, you know, not joke thing, you know. We are ready. So we're excited to hear what you have to deliver for us. But before you do, we're going to ask Mrs. Galloway Hill to pretty much introduce you.
Great, thanks.
Good morning, everyone. It is indeed a pleasure to be given the task of introducing Mr. Gary Matalon. Now, I believe that Mr. Matalon has introduced himself on numerous occasions to the Jamaican landscape. However, just to share with you a little bit more, right? When most of us hear about Gary Matalon, the first word that comes to mind is innovator from the similarly named local TV show. However, Gary Matalon's knack for innovation runs much deeper and wider than that beloved TV show. As an innovator himself, and a trendsetter in his field, Gary Matalon has made a name for himself as a business mogul that is eager to take on new adventures and revolutionize the way business is done in Jamaica and the wider Caribbean. His greatest moments throughout the years have ranged from funding successful businesses and starting his family. Businessman, serial entrepreneur, and certified project manager, Gary believes in turning his personal passions into a thriving career. This led to his bold decision to step away from the family business, Wicon, and pursue his own venture in project management and business development. Matalon achieved his Bachelor's of Arts degree in business management and entrepreneurship from Lynn University in Florida, and then went on to the University of Liverpool to complete a master's degree in business. He also holds the credential of a project management professional, PMP, the highest credential offered in the field of project management from the Project Management Institute. In 2006, Gary teamed up with engineer Dayton Levy to establish Newstone Limited, a project and enterprise management firm specializing in construction and development. Since then, Newstone has managed the construction of major commercial and residential establishments such as Vistaprint, the Marriott Courtyard, Richmond Estate, and many others. As director of Newstone, Gary draws on his experience and training in the field to deliver excellence and innovation to each project. 2 years after starting Newstone in 2008, Gary co-founded the Kingston Live Entertainment KLE Group with his wife, Tina, and a group of other business partners. As director and CEO of the KLE Group, Gary is responsible for the development of premium lifestyle and entertainment establishments, such as Fiction Lounge and Famous Nightclub, and restaurants, namely Usain Bolt's Tracks and Records, and more recently, Luxury Real Estate Bessa. Under his direction, the group owns and manages the Usain Bolt's Tracks and Records brand. Prior to the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, they had four operating locations, including their first international unit in London, England. Gary is also the director of Franjam, a franchise company that was founded to own, develop, and license Jamaican-themed restaurants. Franjam creates opportunities for investors by way of buying into the Jamaican franchise concept. Gary also served as the chairman of the board of directors for the Hillel Foundation, an organization charged with the task of raising funds for Hillel Academy Scholarship Program, Staff Endowment, and Capital Fund. Despite his enormous success in the field of business, however, Gary considers himself to be a family man first. And he claims that some of his greatest successes are the persons around his dining table. He is the proud father of three children, Sydney, Jacob, and Haley, and the husband to Tina Matalon, his partner in work and life. Now, please put your hands together and give Mr. Matalon a warm, Excelsior-style welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that introduction. And I just want to thank Excelsior for putting together this career conference. And I've been fortunate enough to sit through some of the other presentations, and it's been very insightful. And, you know, I just really feel honored to be able to kind of share some of my own experiences with you guys as well. Thanks to Mr. Peart and the team for inviting me to have this chat with you. So I am now going to attempt to share my screen, which I hope to not have any big issues doing. Let me see here. Okay. All right, I think we're in business. All right, are you seeing the presentation? Should be a title slide. I hope. All right. Okay, so essentially, entrepreneurship is a massive topic, right? And I think more than anything else, what I would really love to achieve here today, what I would really love to achieve here today is to really have an opportunity to share with you some of the things that you may not have learned in school or even by a lot of the other presenters, right? So there's a lot of theory around the entrepreneurial process and, you know, what it takes to be a successful entrepreneur and those sorts of things. And of course, I went through, you know, all of the theoretical learning myself, right? I did my undergrad, I did my master's degree. In fact, one of my degrees is in management and entrepreneurship. So literally went through all of the theoretical learning that there is to learn. And because, you know, I just was dead set in my mind that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I wanted to do my own thing. And, you know, it was a situation where, you know, coming out of all of that preparation, you feel like you're ready and you feel like, you can't miss. And then, of course, you kind of get into the thick of it. And you know, things are all of a sudden not going the way that you had anticipated. And what I want to achieve here today for you is not to kind of go back over all of the learning that you've learned already or to even highlight some of the points that maybe have been discussed. My hope today is really I want to put forward to you guys three things that for me, after all of the preparation and after all of the training and after all of this, the conferences and seminars and everything else, these are things that maybe I never had a full appreciation for. And as I went out in the world, these things kind of started to become more apparent to me. And hopefully by me explaining this to you ahead of time, it will help to prepare you a little better so that you can think about these things as you're going through your entrepreneurial journey. So, you know, again, there are a host of different definitions. I even think Javed earlier had his own definition for what entrepreneurship is. And I'm not going to get into that because ultimately I think that you all are going to have to write your own story, and it's certainly going to be different than everybody else's. And I say all of this to say that, you know, I'm not diluting the points that are taught, the theoretical learnings that are so important. You need those, and you don't want to just learn them, you want to study them, you want to understand them, because those things will form the ammunition that you are going to need to be able to deal with what is to come, right? So the next three things that we discuss is not meant to take away from anything else that you've learned before or anything like that. It's really just kind of give you another perspective so that you will hopefully have a better appreciation for some of the things that I went through that you will likely go through as well. And then beyond that, now I will also mention three more things that I want you to remember regardless of what happens in life, because those three things, the latter three things, I think are things that you just cannot afford to forget. All right. So what are my three things that I want you to fully appreciate from day one? You know, as I said before, it was always kind of my desire to want to be my own boss and to do my own thing, right? So there was always this feeling that, you know, you had to just, you know, come up with something that nobody else has come up with before. And in truth and in fact, that's a bit of a misconception, right? I think, you know, once I realized that, hold on a second, there are other people in business already that are doing an exceptionally good job, that have gone through a whole lot of learnings and have done things the hard way and have suffered and have been through hell and have come out on the other end. And, you know, when it occurred to me that, hold on a second, I don't necessarily have to do everything from scratch. I can learn from these people that have done it before. And I can, and you know, whether it is that you're starting a restaurant, whether it is that you're starting a law firm, whether it is that you're starting a lemonade stand, whatever the case is, you have an opportunity to learn from the people that did it before you. You do not need to reinvent the wheel every time. You do need to be unique, and you need to differentiate yourself from others. So it's not to say that you're going to go there and you are going to just, you know, copy what somebody else is doing. I would never suggest that is an approach that will yield you any great deal of success. But, you know, it is important that an entrepreneur is not necessarily an inventor. An entrepreneur is somebody, as was mentioned earlier, is somebody that's going to go there and solve problems and is going to realize a vision by really kind of putting together a plan, deciding a strategy and executing it, right? You need to do it. You don't need to be entirely unique that you're finding something that nobody else has ever done before. Chances are, you know, people come up to me all the time, especially when we're shooting innovators. People say, I have an idea. You know, 99% of the time, somebody else has already kind of had that idea as well. And it's really not going to be about, your idea being the first time anybody has ever thought about it. You're not trying to invent the light bulb, right? You just want to differentiate yourself enough that you can separate yourself from the rest, right? Find your lane and execute it. That is really something that I think is going to help to unlock people's potential, because I think it can be a bit restrictive if you're trying to be too unique and you're trying to really kind of create something from nothing. And that is something that I think will be very important. Get your learnings from the people that did it before you. So this next point that I raise is something that I learned the hard way, right? And I, starting out in business, was, whether it was influence from the older generations or whether it was just what society had taught me, I very much tried to keep everything close to my chest. So I wasn't sharing anything with anybody. I was trying to do the thing my own way. And the reality is, what I found is that as time went on, I had a lot of successes in a lot of areas, but I had a lot of massive challenges in other areas. And the reason for that is that there are things that I'm not great at. I'm just not good at all. I mean, I can tell you, you know, Alex made a presentation a while ago. Javed made a presentation a while ago. I probably knew maybe 1/10 of what Javed said before he made the presentation. He's way smarter than me in what he knows well, right? So the truth is, I can't compete with somebody like him in his area of expertise. And I don't think we need to try, right? I find that my strengths are operational. I like to get the job done. I like to have the plan and execute it, but I'm not necessarily the best finance guy. So it wasn't until I started to look at ways to collaborate better. When you can get into true collaboration, you become plenty more effective. So it's really going to be, not to say you shouldn't teach yourself as much as you can teach yourself, because I have become much better in areas of like, you know, reading contracts, legal type stuff. But I still try and surround myself with the smartest people in that area. Likewise, on the finance side, if it is a situation where, you know, I need to make sure that my reports are the best, most effective reports that I can make decisions off of, I know I'm not the best person to make that happen, but I can try and put the right people around me, or I can try and tap into the expertise of others to be able to kind of really shore up that side of the business, right? So fill in the gaps. Find out what it is you're not that great at and see how you can fill that gap, right? Nobody is good at everything. And the most successful people in the world are what you're going to find out some great people around them. And that is also one of the things that, again, as you go through your learnings and you study different aspects of entrepreneurship and business in general, you may not really get a full appreciation for, hold on a second, even though I'm studying this and I need to understand it and I need to have appreciation for it, at the end of the day, I don't need to be the expert in it. There are other people that are experts that are way better than me in it, right? So I always say I never try to be, if I'm the smartest person in the room, I'm in the wrong room. So I really want to be, you know, have the smartest people around me. And ultimately, I think that makes for a much stronger way forward. And the third thing that I don't think anybody ever really came out and told me, you know, explicitly, is that you will fail, right? And this is an interesting one, because I think a lot of people don't talk about the failures along the way as much as they do the successes. And I don't know if that is because they're embarrassed by it. I know in Jamaica, it's a small community and a lot of people don't like, you know, to talk about those things. But the reality is, I think that it's very important, probably the most important thing on this entire slide for you to understand. The reality is nobody gets it right 100% of the time. Nobody, I don't care who you are. The most successful business people, the most successful entrepreneurs in the world have had massive failures along the way, okay? And what I want to say to you is that not only is it a surety that you will have these challenges, but it's also something that you need to learn to embrace, right? You need to embrace these challenges, right? They are guaranteed, they are going to happen, but it's what you do with them that that is going to really help to make you successful at the end of the day, right? I would say that each and every one of these challenges that face you are going to be the preparation that you need for the success that is to come. So it's not that you're a failure. You're only a failure is if you stop, is if you quit, right? And I'm not saying this to you for you to feel like, oh, when I fail, I'm not to worry about it because Gary said I was going to fail. Anyway, so it is standard, everybody fails. I don't want you to not worry about it. I want you to worry about it, right? Because the objective is not to fail, right? But I'm saying it so that when it does happen, you realize that it's not the end and that it's time for you to pick yourself back up and to keep going. So that is going to be probably the hardest thing you are going to have to do in your entire journey. Right, is going to understand, is going to be to find the drive, find the energy, find the guts and the determination to be able to keep going in the face of, you know, just the worst thing that could ever happen. I mean, it just reached me times where you just feel like, oh my God, is it this? I can't go any further, you know. I've messed up. No, it really is going to be all right. How are we going to overcome this now and start to work on how we get around whatever it is the challenges are? So persistence is going to be key. I mean, you've probably heard some of these things as characteristics of an entrepreneur and stuff like that. And it's not cliche, it is real. You are going to have some guts and determination and persistence. But know that the reason you have to have those things is because you're going to run up into some of the most difficult times that you can ever imagine. And there's always different ways to skin the cat, right? So there's going to be multiple solutions to every problem, even though you may feel like at the initial stages that this is it, like it's just the end. It's just the worst case scenario that could ever reach. So, you know, those three things, I think for sure in all of my schooling, in all of my preparation, I never had a full appreciation for those things. And I think that if you guys keep those things in mind, as you go through your journey, you will definitely have a better sense of how to keep going when you're having issues, when you're reaching the problems. And as I said to you before, there are three other things that I want, you know, if nothing else, and everybody's journey is different, but if nothing else, you just keep these things in the back of your head, because these things are things that you need to realize, and they will become apparent to you. Nobody ever really said them to me, and well, that's not entirely true, but these things are things that I think will serve you very well, and you must always keep them in mind, right? So the first thing is that there is no silver bullet solution, right? You know, I get people coming up to me all the time. How do you become successful? What, you know, what do I have to do? What should I do? And the truth is, you have to write your own story. There is nobody that can tell you exactly what you must do first, second, and third. If I could tell you that, I would tell you and we'd all be successful and we could go home. Be great. But that's not going to happen, right? I'll never forget when I started Fiction Lounge in 2008 in Kingston. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it. But it was a nightclub and, you know, pulled together all this money, got partners involved, got sponsors involved. Was, you know, spoke to people that were in the business, in that business before me, got advice from all different angles. But I had a vision of what this should be, of what the Jamaican market wanted and what this needs to be. And right before we opened to the public, I invited over friends and family to, you know, to just get a sense of what the place was like and to let the staff get some training on real life customers type of thing. And we had a friends and family event, and I'll never forget inviting a cousin of mine who's a supremely successful business person and somebody who I looked up to all my life. And I'll never forget, he came in there and I walked up to him and I felt all proud. And I said, you know, what do you think? You know, how do you like it? And he said, boy, Gary, I hate to tell you this, but I think you should just find somebody to give your shares to. Don't even bother sell them. Give them away. He says, this can't work in Jamaica. This will never work. And, you know, it initially hit me. Emotion washed over me. I felt like I was going to drop down, right? And I wanted to just bawl. Okay, I mean, there's no other way to explain it. I just couldn't deal with hearing this after what I had been through to get the place ready to launch to the public. And, you know, shortly thereafter, I thought about it and I said, all right, you know what? Just because you said that, I'm going to die before this thing fails. And I'm going to ensure this is going to be, I'm going to realize this vision and it's going to be insanely successful. Of course, long story short, unfortunately for me, I was right in that regard. But, you know, here it is, somebody that has done a great job in business, been extremely successful. He just didn't see it. He just did not feel like this was the way to go. I mean, my initial projections for Fiction had us paying back the initial investment in the first year. And I think it was so insanely successful that we paid back for the initial investment in the first 2.5 months. So it wasn't that he was even remotely close to being right. This thing was a smash hit. Okay, so at the end of the day, don't believe that I have all the answers or that any of the other presenters have all the answers or even your teachers have all the answers. I mean, at the end of the day, the professors have learned the theory and you need that. You need those things to be able to help you navigate what is to come. But there is nobody that has all the answers. If there was, we would know. The answers don't. You have to chart your own path. You have to write your own story. So just keep that in mind as you're going down the road. That's not to say you don't learn from people that have done it before you, and you don't use their experiences to help you avoid some of the mistakes and things like that. So and to be even more competitive and to win against your competition. But keep in mind, there is no silver bullet solution to anything. It's going to take a lot of grit and hard work. So the second thing is that it's not like it's a perpetual process, right? Entrepreneurship never ends. It's not like a race where you have a start and you go and you run a race and at the end you're at the finish line and the race is over. When you start a business, it doesn't ever end, right? You have to find a way as a business person to remain hungry. And you not only to keep that fire burning, but also to evolve as time goes on, because what you write as a business plan today is essentially redundant tomorrow. Because why? Because times change, things change, and you are going to need to understand that once you embark on this, it's like raising a child. You have a baby, and then the baby moves from the baby stage to the toddler stage. Then, toddler stage to the young adult, it doesn't ever end. It just changes and it grows. So very similarly in a business, you need to understand that you're not going to say, I did it, right? You're doing it. So that is unless of course you reach retirement age and you hang up your business journey. But of course, we all hope to reach that point at some stage. But that is something that you may not, as you're going through your studies, you may not realize. And as you're embarking on entrepreneurship, you may not realize that, look, I'm in this for the long haul. Let's go. And the last point is something that was said to me. I got invited as a young business person in Jamaica. I got invited by PSOJ to... It was a luncheon. I think it was maybe like a dozen people that were invited, all young business people, and they had a guest speaker. And the guest speaker was Billy McConnell. He just passed away in the last recently, but he was one of the top business people. He was very responsible for Appleton and LaSalle's. A lot of big business in Jamaica, and he was always known. I had always heard, of him as being, just a really great person and somebody who everybody held in high regard, just an honorable business person that was tremendously successful. And when he spoke to us at that luncheon, I'll never forget it. I was kind of waiting for him to kind of, shed some great wisdom on us, about business and how we're to be successful. And he said to me, he said, at the end of the day, for him, it has always boiled back down to relationships. He said, relationships for him are everything. And he always felt that no matter who he came across in business, at whatever level, he would make it his duty to establish a relationship. And he wanted people to understand that it was always going to be about needing to call on people and needing to reach out to people and collaborating with people to be able to make the business successful. And I thought about it when he said it, and I was like, yeah, I'm not so sure if I agree with that. And you know, I'm a young business person, and I'm like trying to blaze my own trail. And, you know, I thought about it, and I'm like, yes, of course you need a good network, and you need to be able to call on people. But, you know, I wouldn't tell people the key to success is going to be in the relationships that you can build. But as time went on, and as I went through my journey, I feel very strongly that this man knew exactly what he was talking about when he said that. And, you know, now that we've just had to endure a couple of years of madness with the pandemic and everything else, it has really been those relationships, you know, that have been able to kind of draw us through and keep us active at the tail end of it, so that we can keep going, and we can pick ourselves back up, and we can barrel through. So I feel a lot more powerful now as a business person, being able to pick up the phone and call some people that I have been in contact with along the way. So for me, I definitely, it is something that I said, you know what, I will always remember that him telling me that, and I know I appreciate it more than ever before. And I want you guys to understand, you know, nobody has all the answers. You are going to need to find out some of the answers on your own to really kind of deliver on your vision and on your dreams. The process never ends, so buckle up. It's going to be a long ride. And remember that the people around you, you're going to want to ensure you operate with integrity. And you are going to need to understand that you need to develop the relationships. And if you forget any of those three things, it's going to come back to bite you, and it's going to hurt you, and you're going to pay the price for that. So don't forget them. So what I really want to do at this point is, I wanted to keep it brief, because I want you guys to remember these things. I don't want to just say, you know, give you 20 different points and you're not going to remember half of them. Keeping it tight, because I want you to really put these in your mind and just remember them. They're not going to be the forefront, but keep them in your mind at all times, and they will serve to help you. So at this point, what I'd love to do, though, is kind of hear from you guys. And it's one of the reasons why I'm sorry it's a virtual platform, because, of course, I'd love to be there physically with you. But since we can't, I know there is a chat and any other way that you can ask some questions. I'd love to hear what it is that you guys want to know.
All right, there's a question in the chat. What's the biggest mistake you see new entrepreneurs making? What's the biggest mistake you see new entrepreneurs making?
I mean, there are many. What is the biggest one? I'm not sure what is the biggest one. One that I see most frequently probably is just really a lack of planning. I can tell you there are dozens of people that come to me and they say, you know, they have an idea, they want to talk to me about the idea. And the reality is they have not put anything on paper. They have not done anything towards planning out how this is going to work and what they're going to do. And of course, in the initial stages, everybody's like, where can I get funding? Where can I get money? And, you know, everybody says, well, you know, you can't do anything without money. And money is always the issue. Money is always the issue. And the reality is, 9 times out of 10, money is not the issue for entrepreneurs. Because the reality is, if you were to give them the money, they would lose it so quickly. It's not even funny. Having the money is the quickest and easiest thing to lose if you're not really prepared. So there is so much you can do in terms of preparation. And again, it goes back to all of the theoretical stuff that we've been hearing and that you learn along the way. You know, these are the things that you need to understand are going to be key things to you being able to execute on a vision or on an idea. So, you know, I think one of the big mistakes is everybody just kind of rushing to be able to kind of access funding. And maybe sometimes it's a family member that loans you the money, or maybe you've saved up money on your own. And you think, all right, now that makes me ready. It's that I would say is probably one of the most frequent issues that I see with entrepreneurs in general. Mm-hmm. Not just in Jamaica. I think it's a huge problem overall.
Awesome. There's another question in the chat. What's your advice on seeking out a mentor and asking that person for mentorship?
So let me tell you my advice on that, because I get asked to be a mentor on a regular basis. And the truth is, I never really asked anybody to be my mentor. What approach I took was more to kind of learn from different people. And there are people that I, you know, I view as being people I want to emulate and people that I will try my best to have even a fraction of the legacy that they have built. And those people, whether I call them my mentors or not, you know, I try to access them as much as I possibly can. And I have never been a person that if I can help in a situation, I'd be happy to help. But I don't think somebody wants to put all their eggs in one basket either, right? I think the approach to mentorship needs to be more a broader type approach. And again, you know, back to in my first 3 points, there's nobody that knows everything, right? So I may be a good mentor to guide people on one aspect of business, but I certainly would be a horrible one for other aspects of business. Mm-hmm. And I think that is one of the benefits to having a bit of a group of people to pull from.
Awesome. 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 Thank you for that. I'd also like to ask, what's one of the ways that we can build networking, you know, even outside of mentorship? How do we go about as young entrepreneurs to build network with other persons?
There are many ways to do that. I think there are going to be some that some people will find more effective than others. I know when I was just starting out on my own in business, there were there was a thing called a corporate mingle where I think it was like the last Friday of every month, a bunch of young business people would come together and the different venues would host, you know, these mixers and people are just there. And what happens is when you're around like-minded people, the conversation tends to flow very easily. So if you surround yourself with other business people and seek them out and don't be afraid. Look, the more somebody can tell you is no, if you are looking for information, you have to feel like, look, me want information, I'm going to go and get it. You can't sit there and wait for things to come to you. So networking is a thing where I think you make that happen, whether it is you're going to network at a corporate mingle or you're going to network at, you know, a function that PSOJ is putting on or some other Montego Bay Chamber of Commerce or whatever the, you know, Excelsior has events, I would imagine, from time to time. So there are going to be different ways for you to get access to people. And you need to just, again, just like business, you're going to have to try and chart your course to being able to access the information that you need and that you want.
Thank you for that. All right, we have a couple more questions. Matthew is saying, back in the days, most successful entrepreneurs started to build their wealth before having a master's degree or finishing school at the tertiary level. We are now encouraged to finish at the tertiary level, then begin building our wealth. With your experience, what are some of the advantages and disadvantages of this change?
So it's interesting you say that, right? Because I have a very interesting perspective on the school aspect of it. I think that the theories and the approaches and the different methodologies and practices are all very, very relevant.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether you are going to, I've never used, but then again, you're going to learn a lot of things that will absolutely serve you in no way, shape or form. And you wonder, well, why am I even learning this, right? I can't recall using calculus or trigonometry in any of my
dealings
since leaving school, right? But the reality is what school does, in my opinion, is school prepares you to learn and to solve problems. So although you may not be leaving school to turn around and apply exactly what you learned in school, what the most important thing you learned at school does for you is teach you how to learn. And in business, you are going to never stop learning, right? So the harder you are to learn is the harder licks you are going to take, right? When you learn quick and you can, you have the ability to make adjustments and navigate the challenges, then you're going to reach where you need to reach a lot quicker. So I would say to you that, you know, I don't know for a fact that more entrepreneurs finish tertiary or don't. I don't know those statistics, but I would say to you that there have been some. I mean, you would have read about, you know, Facebook and this company and that company where, you know, people have dropped out of school, didn't finish. You know, I don't think that that's the majority of successful business people. I think the majority of successful business people have had the good fortune of being able to get the training. Is the training going to be what you need to be successful? Not in its entirety, not at all. And is it absolutely a prerequisite for you being successful? Not at all either. But if you have the chance to be able to complete your tertiary and get as much training as and as much preparation as you can, I would say do that. Because as I said to you, you are going to take licks. You are going to fail. That I am telling you is guaranteed. Right, you're not going to be a failure, because the only way you're is if you give up at that point. And to be quite honest with you, people set out on an entrepreneurial journey and eventually pull the plug, and I think that's okay too, because I don't think it's for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but you are going to have to, if you are going to be successful as an entrepreneur, you're going to start something and build it and grow it. You're going to need to understand that. The blank is going to hit the fan, and when it does, you understand how you are going to deal with it, and you have to be able to pick yourself up and keep yourself going. And so that is easier done the more prepared you are. You're going to war, and you need to have all of the ammunition you can possibly have. That's what I would say to you.
Wise words. Wise words. Shanique is asking, what are your favorite aspects of being an entrepreneur?
These are all great questions. So I think that for me, the greatest thing is really kind of having a vision and believing in it. Again, you know, when you birth a business concept or idea and then you have to plan it out and then you have to execute it, it's really something that allows you to I don't think there's a better feeling than to see that kind of evolve. I mean, I have a construction background and I can I can parallel it to, you know, seeing a plan in two dimensions on a piece of paper, and then, you know, 6 months or 12 months later, seeing actual, you know, structure in front of you that people walking in and enjoying and that sort of thing. And for me, that is probably one of the greatest feelings, is to see your vision through to reality and having an impact on people, right? Because any business is really solving a problem for people. Whether it is a restaurant, you're providing an experience, or you're providing a particular you know, type of food or professional services, you're providing some kind of solution for people to be able to achieve their goals or to you know, whatever, whether it's leisure, whether it's business, whatever the case is, you're providing a solution to people, and to be able to see that all happen, and then people actually enjoying your product and service is probably one of the greatest feelings, I would have to say. As well as equally as much is just providing employment, right? So, I mean, I've had businesses that have employed over 200, 250 people. I have a business now, a separate business that is employed about 50 odd people. And that's great. I have people that have worked for me for 12 years, for 15 years. And, you know, it's no longer, and I it's funny, I say work for me because I really and truly, I don't feel like anybody works for me. I feel like we work together. And it is a situation where I think those are the things about entrepreneurship that nobody can really teach you. That's something you have to feel for yourself. And when that bug bites you, it becomes something that it just becomes a part of you and will keep you driven, I think, more than anything else.
Thanks for that. Final question from the chat is, for someone with a good product or service and a plan to execute, but no capital or funds are available from family or friends, can you state some of the entities and investors that you know of that would help to get funding, help them to get funding?
So I think there are a few, and I'm going to mention them, but the reality is before you even go there, you're really going to have to dig in. And I know you said you're starting with a good plan, but you're really going to have to dig in and develop a plan. I met with some entrepreneurs the other day that are looking to execute a plan, and the plan was so amazingly well put together, but what it didn't have was any other scenario. So it was a plan that was unbelievable, the amount of work that went into the plan. But you know, if I said to them, well, what happens if that doesn't materialize? What happens if you have a different scenario? What's your worst case scenario? What do you do then? And of course, I don't think they had thought through that aspect of it. Likewise, you can have a situation where you undershoot, right? As I mentioned to you before, in fiction, we thought we were going to pay back in a year. We paid back in a couple of months. I mean, that's the other extreme, which is a great situation to have. But I think you need to really put together the great plan. Once you have the great plan, it becomes a little bit more within reach for you to find investment. And there's different ways to find investment. You could potentially collaborate with somebody who may be in the same industry, but in a slightly different type of business. And under a non-disclosure agreement, you can pitch the idea to them. Businesses are always looking for other ways to invest and to horizontally integrate and to vertically integrate. That, I think, is one of the ways that people don't really realize that it is potentially an avenue for funding their business ideas, right? Also, it was mentioned a couple of times earlier. I know Jacqueline mentioned the First Angels network, which happens to be chaired by my cousin, and Sandra Glasgow is very involved in. And what they do and what's good about them is that They are essentially very sophisticated investors, and they are successful business people that make up that network. And what they created the network because they realized that there is a tier of financing options that doesn't exist really in Jamaica. So venture capital and angel investing, which is a dynamic, well-established way to access funding for entrepreneurs in some of the more developed markets, isn't really very well developed here in Jamaica. So they've started to create them. So the angel investors network is great. And as I was saying to you, what is great about them is that because they are successful business people and because they're actually investing their own money into your business, they're also going to ensure that you have certain governance in place, right? Because if I'm going to invest my money, the first question I'm going to ask myself is my money safe or is my money at massive risk here, right? And, you know, when I'm looking at an opportunity or when any funding option is looking at opportunity, whether it is an equity investor or whether it is somebody providing debt, they're going to ask themselves a couple of questions. One is going to be, who is behind this business? Is when this person buck up the first failures that Gary was talking about, are they going to fall upon debt? I'm not putting my money there, right? So I need to be able to read the crowd and determine that this is an entrepreneur that I can bet my money on. The second thing is, how well have they done their homework? How well prepared are they for the risks and for when all hell breaks loose? So, I mean, when I went for my first ever funding for Tracks and Records, we went to one of the largest institutions in Jamaica and with the greatest business plan. And they dragged me through the course for 3 months. And at the end of 3 months said, we're very sorry. We think it's too risky a proposition. We're not going to provide the money to you.
And
I thought I was going to die. Of course, I turned around. I went to the second largest financial institution in the island and did the whole same pitch again. But I said to them, look, guys, I did this already for 3 months with the other guys. And they came back and they told me no. So if the answer is, if there's no hope for me on this thing, please just tell me sooner than later. That's all I have. They came back to me in a week and they said, we're very sorry, it's too risky a proposition. So I left there thinking, all right, so I ain't going to be able to get the money to do this thing. So what am I going to do? I was now starting to kind of go through in my mind, who are the people that I think would be potentially good private investors to come on board with me. And I was going to go start presenting to them or trying to get in touch with them, whoever they may be. And it was somebody that came to me and said to me, why don't try this other bank? And I said, I've been to two of the largest already. And they told me, no, why is this third one going to be any different? And they said to me, well, just try. The most thing you can do is tell you no. So I went and I made a presentation. I did the person in the room I had met, I knew, I didn't know them personally, but I had met him before. And he was the head of the bank. He sat in the room with three of his other guys. He asked me a bunch of questions. I made a presentation for about 45 minutes. And then at the end of the presentation, he said, when do you need the money by? And I said, well, I need it like a month ago. And he said, well, I can't give it to you a month ago, but I can probably get it to you in about a month. And I thought, I left the meeting so just perplexed. I couldn't figure out why this was so different. And I thought to myself, well, you know what? Let's see what happens. A month later, the money was in the account and we were able to proceed with the business and open the doors, right? And when the money hit the account, I said to myself, I have to find out what went into this decision. So I called him and I said, it sounds strange, but I need to know, why did you give me the money? And he said, you know why? Because when you sat across the table from me and you told me about this, you told me with so much passion and so much determination and so much emotion that I knew my money was safe. Him said, I knew my money was safe. So he took a risk. Now, I'm not saying that that's going to happen in all cases, right? But I was desperate at the time. I knew I had done my homework. I knew that I had risk mitigation measures in place. I knew that the business was going to be successful. I was going to ensure it was going to be successful. And I borrowed the money. And of course, every dollar of it was paid back. And, you know, he made a good business decision. I made a good business decision. And we went on about our way. But I tell you all of that to say that I don't think, again, there's a silver bullet answer for any of these questions. I can only tell you what I have had to endure and some of the things that I have been through. You're going to go through things maybe similar, maybe they'll be very different. But the most important thing is that you are going to have to navigate whatever comes your way and ensure that, you know, you're going to be successful. So,
absolutely. I mean, two no's and then a yes. Eh? The last question is from Matthew, and he's asking, would it be wise to invest in the stock market?
Yes. I mean, look here, the stock market over time has shown that it's a relatively safe place for your money. I would say no if you're planning to become a short-term investor or a day trader. I think that's very difficult. But in the longer term, as much as the stock market jumps up and down and goes all over the place, you know, over time, the trajectory is pretty consistent. And I would say, I mean, I only got involved in the stock market in the last couple of years. I really wasn't an investor in the stock market for a long time. And the real reason for that is because I didn't understand it. And as much as I am familiar with a lot of the businesses on the stock market, I don't know their business model and I don't know the details of their business. And I don't think you should invest in anything you don't have some good feeling of, some good appreciation for. So in other words, I would never invest in a company that I've never heard of or that is in a line of business that I don't know anything about. So if you look at my portfolio, it's all business that I'm very familiar with. And for one reason or the other, I feel like this is a company of the future. This has great growth prospects, or it's a solid company for whatever reason. Not to mention that you also need to understand that there are financial indicators that you need to understand. So, you know, price to earnings ratios, these kinds of things. If you're planning to invest in the stock market, you are going to want to educate yourself on those things. And again, remember, finance not being my wheelhouse, I kind of shied away from it. But I'm glad I'm involved in the stock market now to a very small extent. It's definitely not the lion's share of my portfolio, but it is somewhere that I think can be good. But I say that with a little caveat that you need to know what you're doing. You can't just go in there blind.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Mr. Matalan. But Mrs. Lucretia McGraw is going to come to give you her official vote of thanks, after which Mr. Peart will come. Oh, the other way around. Nigel Peart is going to come before, and then Mrs. McGraw is going to come and give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Matalan, just to say that, you know, that we have been through, and to be at this point, so for sure, your argument of seeing something come to life and fruition, I'm having that moment now. Just want to like to say, speak to students out there. Now that we have planted the seed for entrepreneurship, and you know, it's just percolating in your brain also. Our unit, out of this engagement, what we want to create is that we would love if you register with us. If you know of anybody who is a past student of the college and has their own business, what we want to develop is a business directory for persons with their own business out there, okay? So you can share with us, send it to, you can send the info to work experience at ecc.edu.jm. Give us the name of the business, what they do, where they're located, so that we can create a directory. And we will put that, possibly we aim for our website, that anybody can go on it and see what businesses we have at the college, through the college. And, you know, anywhere to get your name out there, if you are a wise entrepreneur, you would log on to this, okay? Here we are giving you free advertisement, all right? And you know, if you're in business, if you're planning to go in business, one of your bigger costs can be marketing. So anywhere you can get it, you can take it. And we will post it up online so that others can see what's there, who are the persons, what they have to offer, and book your service. So that's just something that we has germinated from here. And we would love for you all to log into that. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on the occasion of our annual career conference. I, on behalf of the Career Placement and Service Unit at Excelsior Community College and the entire Faculty of Management here, extend a very hearty gratitude to all the speakers for gracing us with your presence and well receive invaluable input in our conference on this virtual platform today. Our keynote speaker, Mr. Gary Matalon, our esteemed principal, Mr. Fillmore McCarthy, vice principals, Mrs. Naomi Jacobs, and Dr. Zaria Malcolm Walker, heads of department and deans of our faculties and schools, honored guests, past and present students. It has been our pleasure to host all the participants of the conference as your presentations have added value to our lives. You have taken time out of your busy schedule to be here today, and we truly appreciate your sacrifices. I express sincere appreciation to all our speakers and delegates for their enthusiastic participation. Mrs. Andrea Williams from the JBDC, who informed us of the avenues which are available to help prospective entrepreneurs on their way forward. Mrs. Jacqueline Lloyd Carter, also from the JBDC, who educates us on how to locate financing for new ventures and the services the financiers may offer. The importance of registering a business was also mentioned. Mr. Javet Nixon from the Seaford Holding Limited explained about the expedited changes that COVID brought about, which presented a faster way of doing business, which resulted in such situations as automation and the solutions that resulted from the innovations, also for schooling us on the fourth industrial revolution, which is driven by digital technologies. Mr. Alex Morrissey spoke to us about website designs, how to operate your website. He also talked about the fact of his music site that he created, and that, of course, online streaming is the way the world is going today. Finally, but by no means least, Mr. Gary Matalon, our keynote speaker, spoke on the fact that collaboration is very important. You are not able to do it on your own at all times. Aligning with the right people and expertise is very necessary. Finding your niche, what you do best and work at it. You must network. Failure is a possibility, but don't give up. He also gave three key points. There is no silver bullet, meaning that you may not get it right all the time, but you find your own story. Next point, remain humble because things change and business may change as you go along. Build key relationships, which will help you to prevail through unforeseen circumstances. Entrepreneurship is an ongoing process and should be done with integrity. Your presentations have all captured the theme of our conference, Entrepreneurship, the Choice of a Sustainable Future, in such a beautiful and profound manner that I am confident that they have successfully planted seeds of creativity and innovation in the minds of our students as well as our other participants. This will indeed cultivate a plethora of ideas which will soon germinate into the creation and birth of several future successful entrepreneurs for years to come. It was made eminently clear that entrepreneurship is a journey that is definitely worthwhile taking and continues to be a foregoing driver in the economic and financial independence and successes of the present and future generation. I must express our deepest appreciation for sharing with us some of your best entrepreneurial viewpoints. We are all inspired by your insights, experiences, and expertise in the area. I express immense gratitude to everyone who contributed to the successful planning and execution of this year's career conference. I also thank our Master of Ceremonies, Ms. Shoshana White, for masterfully hosting today's proceedings. Reverend Alvin Ross for his inspirational devotional, the School of Performing Arts for providing entertainment in the form of Mr. White for this occasion. And a big thank you to Mr. Nigel Pitt, Director of the Career Placement and Service Unit, and his team members for the seamless organization of this enlightening event. I'm also thankful to the administration in general for rendering us with all possible logistic supports regarding organizing this event, including the marketing department for the beautiful banner and posters, the ICT department for technical support with the public address system, internet connectivity, among others, and the maintenance department for the setting up and organization of the room and for all other duties they perform to ensure the success of our conference. It would be remiss of me to omit thanking the Lord, our Creator, for giving us the wisdom, strength, knowledge, and skills to execute this event. Finally, I say a big thank you to all the other persons who worked behind the scene to ensure the complete success of this conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for being here with us this morning to this afternoon. Thank you for being a part of our virtual career conference. Until next year, do enjoy the rest of your day.